Arts, Social Sciences, and Humanities. And welcome. So tonight we have a wonderful program, obviously, because you guys are all here. This is part of the Experience UWF Downtown Lecture Series. And this installment tonight is in conjunction with the Ross Music Hall Artist Series and the UWF Dr. Grier Williams School of Music. So if you've not been part of or participated in the Downtown Lecture Series, this series showcases artists and scholars of outstanding prominence who promote the value and role of the liberal arts in building and sustaining contemporary culture. So tonight we have Mícheál and Owen Ó Súilleabháin, and they are going to present A Stór Mo Chroí, or Love of My Heart. And before I pass it over to Mr. Corey Kern, I want to do a couple of housekeeping notices that you may use your cameras, just no flashes. And if you have to go to the bathroom, you need to exit the building, go around the back, go up a ramp, and into the building behind us. So that's what you have to do. And then also, right after this, there will be a reception at the Museum of Commerce. There's a map on the back of your little thing here. And I'll also tell you a bit more about that after the show. So now I'd like to introduce Mr. Corey McKern, who is director of the School of Music.
Thank you very much, Dean Mitchell Cook. Welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure to see you all here. And I just want to say first that the School of Music is honored to be partnering with the Downtown Lecture Series. It's great for us. And I'm new to the position of director of the School of Music. And truthfully, the credit for this evening goes to my colleagues, Howard Reddy, who is the Vice President of Development, and Sheila Dunn, who is our former director of the School of Music. And when I asked Sheila, how did this idea come about? She said a couple of things. And then she said, well, really, it was just another good idea by Howard. And so Howard went to school with these gentlemen, and the bond that they created through being students together and music has kept them in touch all of these years. And they arrived 2 days ago, and yesterday we're on campus doing some coachings and classes and master classes for us. And I sat through one of their master classes and I was completely blown away. These gentlemen are the foremost interpreters of traditional Irish music. And they, in music, particularly sort of classical and folk and these idioms, we are an oral and written tradition that is passed down from generation to generation. And in their case, it's particularly passed down. Both their father and mother are experts in this music and pass this knowledge and passion on to Owen and Mícheál. And they have taken it, and they have taken this music from Ireland and brought cultivated discipline to it. And what they offer is a simple, beautiful melodies in this cultivated discipline style that, quite frankly, I don't think I've ever quite witnessed it the same way. They're both fiercely intelligent gentlemen, the time I've spent with them, and we are honored to have them here. And without further ado, please welcome Owen and Mícheál Ó Súilleabháin. Thank you.
Amen. Sa and say Guna, say Guru.
I will arise and go now. I will arise and go now and go to Inish free. You will arise and go now and go to Inish free. We will arise and go now and go to Inish free, and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. Nine bean rows will I have there, and a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee loud glade. And I will have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, slow like the veils of the morning, to where the cricket sings. There midnight is all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and the evening filled with the linnet's wings. We will arise and go now, for always, night and day. I hear lake water lapping, I hear gulf water lapping in low sounds by the shores. When I'm upon the roadway, when I'm upon the roadway or on the pavement's gray, I hear it in the deep heart's core. I will arise and go now, for always night and day, I hear lake water lapping in low sounds by the shore. When I'm upon the roadway or on the pavement's gray. I hear it in a deep heart's core.
but I was young and foolish, and now I'm full of tears, and now I'm full of tears. Downright the sally gardens, my love and I did meet. She asked the sally gardens with her little snow white feet. She bid me take the bees as the grass grows on the leaves. But I was young and foolish, and now I'm full of tears, and now I'm full of
here together for the next handful of minutes, yeah, in this one wild and precious life. It's an absolute honor to be here, and an ecstatic joy, actually. We've had 2 days of working with the students, the music students and faculty, and the beautiful energy that the students have, such a humility about them and an openness. That we've just been blown away by, as well as the faculty have been so welcoming to us. And to step in here to this extraordinary place, this beautiful place that has been protected and maintained and treasured for the significance that it holds and that it bears. Because this doesn't happen by accident. It's such a well-curated place that it's a total honor to be here. Very special time together. So, my name's Owen, and
my name is Mícheál, and you just passed the first test, so congratulations.
We came in there singing a very ancient Irish song, the Shamhos, the old style Irish tradition. And it's a song of lament that has been Christianized as a song of Mary lamenting the death of her child. And then we went into a medieval Gregorian chant. You hear the early start of polyphony emerging there in that one. We learned that from our mother, who recorded a bunch of albums with a bunch of monks on the west of Ireland. We grew up in this monastery called Glenstall Abbey, running around, scurrying around this big old castle on a hill in the forest, and like Harry Potter, but with no women. With it, really. It was an amazing time, and we got to sing that Gregorian chant and learn to sing that Gregorian chant with those monks there too. And then after that,
we did the Yeats view.
When we were putting together the idea for this evening, we thought we'd bring in as much poetry as you can handle.
how is the sound? Can you hear him down the back?
Is the sound okay?
Great. You could turn him up a
little bit. Little bit, yeah. Okay. We can lean in here and try to
explain a bit more. So Vinnie Gates there, the late Isle of Inishfree, followed by one of his beautiful folk songs, The Sally Gardens. The Sally Gardens, which is a great ode to the Mother Nature, really. The healing and restorative powers of Mother Nature.
So that's what we thought we'd start us off with. Yeah, and we want to sort of go from there.
Sure.
We decided to call this evening A Stór Mo Chroí. A Stór Mo Chroí means love of my heart, and it's actually an Irish traditional song that's not on the list, but it could be on the list tonight. I'll give you a patch to it. A Stór Mo Chroí, if you really want to impress or bamboozle your Irish friends, this week of all weeks, you can say, A Stór Mo Chroí.
A Stór Mo Chroí.
And then, well, actually, don't wink at them, you might give them the wrong impression. It goes like this. It's a wonderful melody. It starts real high.
A Stór Mo Chroí, when you're far away from the home that you'll soon be leaving. Tis many's a time by night and by day that your heart will be sorely grieving. For the stranger's land might be bright and fair and rich in its treasures golden. You mine, I know, for days long, long ago, and the ones that will never grow golden. A Stór Mo Chroí, when the evening mists o'er the mountains and seas are falling. Oh, turn the storm from the crowd and list, and 'tis then sure you'll hear me calling. 'Tis the sound of a voice you will surely miss, and one for your speedy returning. Won't you come back soon to the one who has always loved you? Won't you come back soon to the one who has always loved you? It's a special song, actually, to me, especially these months going up to June, because me and my wife are expecting a baby in mid-June. And we told, my wife was born in India, so she's from New Jersey. She's of that clan of the Indian New Jerseys. And we told her parents last night about this, so this is not a secret. But you heard the word there, Arun, Arun, won't you come back soon? Arun also means my love, or my secret love. A Stór Mo Chroí and Arun. And in Sanskrit, Arun means sunrise, or more specifically, the colors around, the colors of red and multicolors around the sunrise. So in Irish it means my secret or my love. And in Sanskrit, in India, it means sunrise. And we're having a boy, so we're going to call him Arun. Come over
down by Killarney's green woods we did stray. The moon and the stars, they were shining. The moon shone its rays on your locks of golden hair. You swore you'd be my love forever. Red is a rose by yonder garden rose, and fair is the lily of the valley. Clear is the water that flows from the pool, but my love is fairer than any. It's not for the parting that my sister pays, it's not for the grief of my mother, it's all for the loss of my handsome Irish lass. You swore you'd be my love forever. Fair is the lily of the valley. Clear is the water that flows from the moon. But my love is fairer than.
This whole collaboration with the university here, with the music department, we were talking about this before COVID, so this is actually over 2 years in the making, and we haven't had very many concerts since COVID, actually, so it sort of feels like this event is us getting back on the road, which is great. We have another, we're doing another series of concerts with a string quartet, with those songs, and this is a great way to rehearse those. Because when there's a string quartet, it has to be perfect, you know. So, this is a great way to get the old muscles back.
Many of you know it's important to say at the beginning that we are brothers, just in case you see us giving each other strange looks. It's not impolite if it's family.
It's not passive aggressive, it's just family. So, this song is in Ireland. There's an old tradition of a nomadic tradition. And they call themselves the Irish Travellers, the Traveller tradition. And it's a whole ethnicity. They have language, their own language, and an amazing culture. And for as long as memory has lived, they've travelled around the country and around the British Isles, making their home nomadically, living nomadically, you know? And what was fascinating with the Irish Travellers recently was as Irish society became more civilized and started to forget the old Gaelic and Celtic ways, the culture, parts of the culture survived in the traveler community that would certainly have been lost had they not maintained a separation from civilized settled society. And so in the 1960s, there was a great cultural revival in Ireland that our parents were a big part of. And people started to go back to Irish culture and to reevaluate what Irish culture meant. Because for a period of time, all things Irish and Celtic were considered very disdainful and distasteful. They were to be looked down upon. It was thought of as a backward, peasant culture that was not part of the civilized Western European tradition. And even going as far back to our grandparents, My grandmother was a little uncomfortable with her daughter, who was a very trained, brilliant singer, singing this Irish language music. You know, it made her feel a little bit uncomfortable. Why would she sing these old Irish language songs when she could so beautifully sing, you know, Judy Garland or any of the kind of modern songs of the day? And so back around this time, people went back to the traveller community and discovered that they had held and preserved parts of Irish culture that had been totally lost in the settler community, especially the Irish piping tradition, the Irish Uilleann pipes. And the Irish Uilleann pipes, we're all familiar with the bagpipes, I presume. And the bagpipes are war pipes. They're played standing up and marching into battle. And that kind of makes sense if you think about the sound that those things make. Yeah? The Irish Uilleann pipes are played sitting down. Yeah, they're not blown into. One you have to sit down, and one elbow feeds air into the bag that blows through the bellows. So it makes a far more mellow, genteel, domestic sound. Yeah? And so very often in the Hollywood movies, when you see a bagpiper, it'll be an Uilleann piper actually playing. It's a little softer in the ears. And this tradition was lost in the settler community, but the travellers had preserved it. And they would play at fairs and at public events around the country. They'd play the Uilleann pipes and be, you know, as buskers. So people went back and really revived that tradition. So this song is also from that tradition. We bring groups of people to Ireland and we bring in one of the pipe makers. He grew up in a wagon with 10 children, and his family traveled around the country, and they all played music, and they all played the pipes. He now is one of the greatest pipe makers in the world. He has order list of years. Mickey Dunn is his name, yeah. And so he comes and performs and brings his family to our group. We sing this song with Mickey Dunn and his daughters. It's a style of song shared in Ireland, Scotland, and England. It's kind of a classic story of a lad turning up to a lover's window and being slightly insistent, and then they let him in and they hang out, and then he leaves at dawn on a horse. We've all heard this story before. I mean, we've all been there, so. There's many different versions, but this is our one.
Love within and all.
She's raised her all from her down soft pillow. She's raised her all and she's let it through. And they were locked in each other's arms until that
prevailing times, to know the right hat for the right company, and rhythm of each interaction chiming in from the periphery to read the grain of every conversation. For I would wish to grow wise through gears of existence, to read the gradient in each phase of life, just a coast down the slopes beyond travailing times, to know the right hat for the right company and rhythm of each interaction shining in from the periphery to read the grain of every conversation. To fall in love in the prime of life. Seeds sown of deathbed smiles and waves of well-being lap at low tide, imploring your reluctant side to break even one cycle learned as a child, for wisdom knows what to hold and what to hand on, which to give and what to keep, where to dig and what to bury, when to wake and how to sleep. Our wish for wisdom, still a whisper, the source of which still buried deep soul, soul brother and soul sister. Are we changed by what we meet? To fall in love in the prime of life. Seeds sown of deathbed smiles and the waves of well-being lap at low tide, imploring our reluctant side to break even one cycle learned as a child, for wisdom knows what to hold and what to hand on, which to give and what to keep, where to dig and what to bury, when to wake and how to sleep. Our wish for wisdom, still a whisper, the source of which still buried deep soul. Soul brother and soul sister, are we changed? Are we changed by what we meet? For oftentimes, The step backward allows the soul catch up. So that all our happy hindsights harmonize and wisdom builds. And share your luck. Be miserly only with misfortune, for in each seismic shudder we learn to trust the ground again. Humble again, knowingly broken, unrepentantly wounded and proud to bear pain. Laying claim to the joy factory of your body. No more tariffs. No more tariffs or sanctions. Wage cuts and glass ceilings, conventions, expenses paid, nor lanyards and company position this way. You can live in ways others simply will not. Develop sides of yourself others simply would not. So, feel a rhythm beyond a beat, begin with a break, and allow your soul catch up. Laying claim to the joy factory of your body. No more tariffs or sanctions, wage cuts and glass ceilings, conventions, expenses paid, nor lanyards and company position this way. We can live in ways others simply will not, develop sides of ourselves others simply would not. So feel a rhythm beyond a beat. Begin with a break and allow your soul catch up. Those are two poems of mine. You passed the second test. First is called, thank you. The first is called What to Hand On, a Dickinsonian style piece, you know. A big shout out to Emily Dickinson. And she could have walked these very streets. And the second was called Thrus the Onam. Thrus in the Irish language means a journey, and the Onam is your soul. So Thrus the Onam means journey of your soul. And I wrote it after Owen mentioned earlier that we bring groups to Ireland every summer, but we had our first group in Ireland, and I was just so moved by the fireball friendships that we all create during these 2 days with students, but also on these 7-day experiences that when we gather together and read poetry, much like Owen's recitation of W.B. Yeats' Lake, Isle of Inishfree, but also my own. And when we, you know, enter into that space where we mix freely conversation, poetry, music, and a walk on the land, that I was moved. No more tariffs or sanctions, wage cuts and glass ceilings, conventions, expenses paid, nor lanyards and company position. This way we can live in ways others simply would not. Develop sides of ourselves others simply would not. You know, that would not. Often when we're on the right path, when we're making progress in our lives, we have to leave behind some of the friends who are not ready yet. And that would not implies our own hopeful progress in this very, very strange world. So thank you for listening. I'll give you another one in a while. I can tell you're digging it.
It's fascinating. You know, we're in conversation too with faculty from the university about what they call the Irish experience, and they bring groups of students to Ireland to have this experience abroad. And you know, coming from Ireland, if you know the history of Ireland, Ireland is an island in the North Atlantic. It's north, very, very north. And if you look at a map, you see how north it is. The north of Ireland actually is parallel with the southern panhandle of Alaska. Yeah? And so it's way up in the North Atlantic. But there's this magical thing that happens in Ireland that makes it into what it is. You know, it's fascinating how geography actually dictates so much of how we meet the world and how the world sees us. But there's a stream that somehow comes from this gulf and shoots up the east coast of the US, and then for some blessed reason turns its head and makes a beeline over to Ireland.
and it hits the Irish coast, but it licks the Irish coast. It licks there just enough so that even in December, the grass can grow. In a protected little sun trap, a rose can even appear in December. I'm not making this up, this is the truth. God's honest truth. While you're literally baking here, we have a slight underfloor heating over there. Yeah, similarly in summer, it can be absolutely freezing there in summer. But it's never cold. So, I mean, when they talk about the Emerald Isle, why it's green, I mean, there's no kind of big freeze that sort of kills things off. And there's nothing actually in the climate that can kill you. There's no hurricanes, there's no tornadoes, there's no earthquakes, there's no tsunamis, there's no volcanoes, no snakes. It's only the people you have to watch out for.
Well, you have to watch out for that.
The drink will kill you.
The drink.
Ireland has been this place in Western Europe, you know, Ireland was this place in the imagination. You'd go to the west of Europe, and then you could go to the British Isles. And then there was another place even beyond it. And it was said, and Britain can get quite cold in winter. It does get a lot colder than Ireland, and Western Europe, it's continental, you know, it's freezing. So you're in England, and there's a story. If you go a little bit further, there's a place out there. And the grass grows in December. And so Ireland has been this place of the imagination that you can go to. It's a safe place, yeah? And it's a place where you can stand at the edge of the known world. And as you see the sunset over the Atlantic Ocean, you're in a place of your own liminal space, a space where you go to imagine a new part of yourself, or to allow a new dawn to emerge, a new voice to come. So over the centuries, over the millennia, the archaeological record shows us that Ireland was a place that people went to for this experience of higher learning, of a new voice that's ready to emerge, of a blossoming in the midst of winter. And so it's a real honor to be part of plugging into that, you know, with the university here, really experiencing that. And it's an invitation to you all to come to Ireland. Artists from all over the world, people from all over the world, of all walks of life, come to Ireland for this very reason. They come back every year, you know. And it's a place where you can just be, you know.
If you somehow can persuade them that you're a University of West Florida student, then apparently it's heavily subsidized. And you can just sail into the beyond, and we'll meet you off the plane and show you what's going on. It was said too that it was an Irish saint who was the first European to land in America. And his name was Saint Brendan. And the Irish saints, Saint Patrick was the first of this beginning of the golden age of Irish history, which was known, when Ireland was known as the land of saints and scholars. And so as the Roman, in Europe, the Roman Empire was starting to fray and crumble and crack. And the peace that the Roman Empire enforced was starting to disintegrate. And all of the great learning retreated to Ireland, to this safe space to be stored. And people, you know, from the royal houses and the courts around Europe would come to the Irish monasteries, these monasteries, to learn Greek and Latin and to study. And there was this culture of these Celtic Christian saints emerged, and they were sort of like warrior gurus, a very robust type of spirituality, and St. Patrick was one of the first of them. Although there was people before Patrick. But Patrick, of course, is the big fellow we all know today. And he was a very robust man, and he would go to the court, he would go straight to the court of the local chieftain, and would march in the door of the great hall, and he would start preaching at the chieftain, and before he could finish, the chieftain would fall on their knees and be converted to Christianity. So eventually the chieftains heard this and they would lock up their doors and close the gates, but Patrick would just start preaching at the gates. The gates would fly up, you know, and the chieftain would go, okay, so I'll go for it. And there's a great story once, Patrick was preaching and he used to go around with his big staff, you know, and he smashed it down into the ground as he was preaching. And as he finished, he looked down and he had pierced the foot of the chieftain who was standing beside him. But the fellow was in such rapture that he didn't dare say anything or move, you know, he just withstood the pain. So there was a great, robust, sort of warrior-like energy that these Celtic Christian saints had. And one of them was a man called Brendan, and he got in a boat with 12 of his lads, and they headed out to that horizon, out into the unknown. And for 7 years, they went on this extraordinary psychedelic magical mystery tour of the North Atlantic. And we know about it because there was a story, the Annals of St. Brendan, were written down in Latin. And at the time, in medieval Europe, this book popped up all over Europe. There are dozens of copies of this book. It was the real blockbuster of the day. It was like the Harry Potter of its time. And everyone was really digging the story of St. Brendan cruising around. And he would have all of these crazy experiences. But he ended up coming home. And we know it's all true because the saints could never tell a lie. But one of the great stories, and we learn about St. Brendan going up in school, and one of the great stories is Brendan goes out and Easter is coming. And Easter is the big high point in the Christian calendar. And so the monks are desperate because there's no land for them to get out and say Mass, Easter Mass. But anyway, on Easter Sunday, this island appears up out of the depths of the ocean. And the monks, anyway, scurry off the boat and they prepare their Easter service. They have their ceremony and they do all the hocus pocus. And the minute it's over, the island starts to sink. You know? So they have to run back into the boat. The island starts to sink and suddenly a big plume of water comes out of the island and they realize that they've been on the back of a whale that had been sustaining them. And for every year, for the next 7 years, the whale would appear at Easter, just in time for them to say their bits and pieces. So we grew up, you know, kids in Ireland hear this story, it's great fun, but one of our great national poets is a man called Seamus Heaney. And Seamus Heaney, he's dead a few years now, but he was the real pioneer of our parents' generation. He was putting into words things that our parents' generation were attempting to do, that reclaiming of Irish traditional culture. And he writes some amazing poems about these old Celtic mythological saints. And he has this one about Brendan and the disappearing island. He calls it the disappearing island. And he says, Heaney's words, "Once we had presumed to found ourselves for good. Once we had presumed to found ourselves for good upon its blue hills and those sandless shores, where we spent our desperate night in prayer and vigil. Once we had gathered driftwood, made a hearth, and hung our cauldron like a firmament, the island broke beneath us like a wave. The land sustaining us seemed to hold firm only when we embraced it in extremis. All I believe that happened there was a vision. The land sustaining us seemed to hold firm only when we embraced it in extremis." There's a Latin word, in extremis, reference to the last rites of the Catholic tradition. In extreme, the last moment, you know. The land sustaining us seemed to hold firm only when we embraced it in extremis, as if our life depended on it. All I believe that happened there is a vision.
Gathering my name, I am with you.
We have a special guest later, so a great friend of ours. We made friends over the years with an Australian actor called Russell Crowe. And people often ask us, like, well, what's Russell Crowe like, you know? It's like, he's exactly the same as he seems on in the movies. That's kind of their trick, you know, they're the same in the movies as they are. They get paid lots of money for it. But anyway, he always said, always bring on a guest who's better than you. So we're doing that later. So we're trying to show off now, so that you might love us.
Okay, help us sing this one too. There's two words in the chorus.
Love, 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 praise you, love, love.
Sing harmonies away if you want. There's a great quote from Pete Seeger that singing harmony is singing any note your neighbor isn't.
You can't debate that. You know,
that's musicologically sound.
Musicologically sound. Okay.
I can feel your heartbeat from a thousand miles. Heaven's open every time you smile. When I come to you, it's right along. Going to you, like a river song. You give me love, 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 love. Crazy love. You give me love, 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 love. Crazy. so far away. Yeah, it was just too long to rise up my day. Take away my nose, you take away my grief. Take away my heartache, every night like a thief. You give me love, 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 crazy love. Take me love, 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 crazy love. And I need you more than any time. And I need you tonight.
Thank you.
Well, I've lost all track of time. The minute he started talking about St. Brendan, I'm like...
7.15, we started at about 6.15, yeah. So I think if
we could do one more, and then we can bring on stage our special guests.
Yeah, okay. I don't know what we're going to do.
Right now?
Yeah.
Why not? I think we should do Miss Rare.
Yes.
Or?
Yes. There we go. Great singers. So there's a beautiful song that we share with our Scottish cousins. Begrudgingly share with our Scottish cousins. You have to give them credit, you know, where credit's due. And you might know this, so feel free to sing along and harmonize your ham. But the deeper theme of this is really a coming together of community to go out into the natural world and gather what is good for us, gather what is healing for us. I dare say we are doing this tonight.
Yeah, and the song, the chorus too, it's actually a question. It's a question, it's an invitation, and it's calling you out, and it's calling this lassie, this little precious part of yourself. You know, will you come out? Will you be seen, you know? And it's not such a big deal. You can just go out among the heather and have a great old time.
There's a very poignant part of this song for me in the third verse. It says, if my true love were gone, I would surely find another to pluck wild mountain pine all around the blooming heather. And I asked my mom, what do you think that line is about? You know, there's not many love songs that talk about the inevitable loss of that which they love so much. And my mother turned to me and she said, oh, that verse is for the old people.
Wild mountain time.
Please welcome to the stage, the Cyclops. Some of you Jungian-minded people out there might recognize the word psychopomp. And really, what a psychopomp is a mythological archetype of God and figure, it's told in the old stories, that brings us from one place to another. For instance, the ferryman across the river Styx in Greek mythology, that archetype is a psychopomp. So if you want to bamboozle somebody after dinner maybe and slightly insult them, you might want to say, go away, you psychopomp. We were talking in one of the classes, we didn't really think we'd go there, but the role of the performer as shaman in any society. And so we're going to initiate these extraordinary volunteers here in the discipline of shamanism. And we're going to sing another song from this old Irish keening tradition that we learned from our mother. And our mother says, this is the oldest song in the world. The oldest song. And again, it's the song of lament, and there's a phrase in it that repeats this refrain, Machon is Machon, Machon is Machon, and it's the sound of lament, of letting go. So we're going to try that one out. By the way, these are students of the music department at the University of West Florida, vocal lit. It's better, there's a lot of music professors in the audience, so the pressure is on.
Mama, I'm going to make me rock.
Inspirational new genre of music called acoustic inspirational pop. So it got the same reception you just gave. And so began our descent into adulthood when one realizes that the world didn't owe me anything.
And this song has followed us through all of these journeys, and we've sung this in all sorts of places with all kinds of very interesting people of all ages. And
actually, it since I mentioned the psychopomp Russell Crowe earlier, this is his favorite song of ours. So, I mean, if you can get through to him,
yeah,
surely.
Actually, one of the heights of our rock stardom was performing this song on stage with Russell Crowe and Hugh Jackman snapping their fingers and singing along to this too. And we were like, that was, yeah.
But no, actually, this is the pinnacle of our career so far, actually. So, this is wonderful.
So there's a little bit of audience participation in this, and we're all friends now, so we don't need to be embarrassed at all. So, everyone take off their shoes. No, I'm not sure.
So in this, we've asked you, it's a somatic exercise, and we're gonna ask you to pant like a dog, and one pants like a dog and also gives it large hip-hop style like this, and one pants four times like this, and then pants four times again. Yep. And now just once. Wait. And now twice. Brilliant. They're still getting the giving it large bit, but they'll get with it. Do we need to rehearse? Yeah, why not? Let's rehearse. Okay. We're on camera back here, so
okay. There's music professors.
So fittingly, the song is called Breathless. So, and it goes like this.
Yes, and before we start, I want to say that this is a song of gratitude and giving thanks. And we really want to give gratitude and thanks to Dean Cook and to Vice President Howard Reddy, and to all of the extraordinary staff and the faculty and students that we've gotten to hang out with, and to all of you for coming out here this evening. We're just filled with gratitude. Thank you so much for having us and for listening with your beautiful listening ears. It's been an absolute joy. So on that note, we're going to rehearse the breath.
Okay.
You leave me breath.
Four times.
You leave me breath.
Four times again.
You leave it breathless.
When I sat at home alone during COVID, I dreamed of this moment.
Anyway, you call me crying in bed.
Yeah.
So, yeah, played the Duke's Dunes and Signalology to go for it.
So much of the green. Now there's going to be a reception in the museum. Apparently there's free stuff going on, and me and my brother are going to. I've got some poetry books and some other things and some flyers for our trips to Ireland. So we're going to go down the back, and then we'll see you in the museum for a cup of tea. How about that? Thank you.
Come to the reception. There's some food, there's some drinks. And again, thank you all for coming.